بطن حياتي، قرآني طهر ذاتي، قرآني عصمة أمري، قرآني طوق نجاتي، قرآني نبض حياتي.
آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان ودعا بدعوتهم إلى يوم الدين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وعملا بفضلك يا أرحم الراحمين. آمين. Honorable brothers and sisters, inshallah ta'ala, to continue with our tafsir lessons, we're going to move on to Surah Al-Nazi'at. Surah Al-Nazi'at has 46 verses and 2 ruku'. We will try to finish one ruku' today, inshallah ta'ala, up to qawluhu subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَأَنْتُمْ أَشَدُّ خَلْقًا أَمِ السَّمَاءُ بَنَاهَا, up to there, inshallah. So the verse starts with qasam, oath from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, by those angels who extract with violence. I'll read the first 5 verses. وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقًا. You could repeat after me in your mind, inshallah. وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقًا. والناشطات نشطا والسابحات سبحا فالسابقات سبقا فالمدبرات أمرا. Whenever you notice there's a wow in Arabic, in Quran, whenever you read, you're going to read so many inshallah verses, والفجر والليل والقمر. Whenever you see a wow, and after that wow you read with a zair or a kasra, like والنازعات والليل والقمر والفجر, then pay a lot of attention to this verse and take a little moment and ruminate. Allah is here taking an oath. Allah is taking a qasam. There is no need for Allah to take a qasam, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would like to talk to us in our language, the way we talk. I'll explain why Allah has taken an oath in the Quran. But whenever you see this like that, والفجر والشمس, we just read so fast, والشمس والضحى, think, والشمس والتين, as I read in Surah Al-Isha today, والتين والزيت, ponder a little. Allah is taking a qasam here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to make a very important statement here. All the statements of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are very important. But here, Allah azza wa jal is addressing the people the way they should address one another. Because the Quran was revealed in Arabic language, the way the Arabs in their culture, they were speaking to one another. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقًا. I swear by those angels who extract with violence. وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطًا. I'll explain this again inshallah. And by those angels who remove with ease. Here Allah is talking about angels who are being appointed to take the souls out. Now the angels, when they take the ruh out, there are 2 ways of taking the ruh out: gently or with violence. So when Allah says وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقًا, this is called in Arabic maf'ul mutlaq. When the angels, they take naza'a means to pull something out. When the angel, they take the soul out, but they do it gharqan, they do it with violence, by force. And you know, the disbelievers, Allah is talking about the disbelievers, the kuffar, the mushrikeen. Allah Azza wa Jal, He commands the angels that go take their soul out and take it so forcefully that becomes very painful for them. And you know what? You watch them, you're not going to notice anything like that. This is the mu'amala of the hereafter. If you look someone in the face, you can't tell someone is going under punishment or not. So don't ever be judgmental as well. For example, some Muslims, if you see like, you know, they're going through the pain, etc., this agony of death, don't say that, you know, maybe like, you know, it's getting punished. No one has any knowledge of that. So you can't say, oh, I was witnessing a death of a disbeliever. It was such a peaceful death. We have no idea about that. The way the angels they deal with, the way they take the soul out, only Allah knows. That's what Allah is saying here. وَالنَّازِعَ, I swear by those angels who have been appointed to take the ruh, the soul out, with violence. And then Allah says at the same time, وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطَى, and I also swear by those angels who remove the soul with ease. These are the soul of the Muslims, the believers. When the angels, they come and take the soul of the believing men and women, then it is said that they take out so calmly. Because what happened is, the person who's in the deathbed, they actually could see the angels within the room. A lot of people have experienced some of your loved one pass away. You're probably thinking that, you know what, why are they looking? They actually could see the angels. That's what they follow. They could see they feel the presence of the angels. And the angels actually talk to them. And they listen and respond to the angels as well. The angel give them glad tidings. They say that نحن أولياؤكم في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة. Don't worry, we're going to be with you all the way now. Don't worry about it. Relax. If you could, inshallah ta'ala, follow Allah's commandments, then that time when you will be on your deathbed, it will be such an amazing time. Everyone else is worried that you're leaving, but you will feel something different, because now you're getting comforted by the angels. We are your friends in the dunya as well as in the hereafter. All the stages of the hereafter, we will be with you. And that's how the soul is taken out. They will give you the glad tidings. Then they take the soul out. When they will take the soul out, they put it into a basket, okay, or a casket that brought from Jannah. And the soul then placed into a cloth from Jannah. And then the angel, they start going towards the heaven. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the next verse. وَالسَّابِحَاتِ سَبْحًا. And by those angels who glide as if they are swimming. Because the angels, when they move from heaven to the earth, from earth to the heaven, it's so easy for them. It's like someone swimming in the pool. Okay? Because the example here is this, that when you are swimming or when you are on a boat, there's nothing in the sea stopping you. It's very easy to like travel. But on earth, you have a mountain, you have a valley, you have trees, you have a roundabout, you have traffic lights. So he is saying that the angels, when they go from heaven to the heaven, or they descend from the heaven, it's like basically they're just gliding and swimming, nothing stopping them. They're doing it with such ease. Okay, the word sabaha, yasbahu in Arabic means to swim. The angels are like very calmly just swimming. That's how they move the soul, very calmly. They take it to the heaven, to Allah Azza wa Jal. Wasabihati sabaha. And by those glide as if they are swimming. So see the connection with the first. The first one is that وَالنَّازِعَاتِ غَرْقَ. This is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is promised by those angels, they take the ruh out with violence. And وَالنَّاشِطَاتِ نَشْطَ. This is when the angel, they take the soul out with ease. And then after the souls are taken out, Allah is talking about the next stage now. Shukran. And by those who glide as if they are swimming. فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبَقَ. And by those who race each other in a race. These are the angels. When Allah says that take this soul and write the name amongst the illiyin, they will say, oh Allah, this is your we will talk about illiyin and sijin inshallah ta'ala in the next, you know, in the other surah that we'll talk about, yeah, in surah al-mutaffifin, waylul mutaffifin. So when Allah says that this man is such a blessed soul, he worshipped me, he followed my commandments, take his soul to Illiyin. The angels, they hurry towards it now. And Allah will say, this is a wicked soul. This is a soul that never remembered me, never prayed, never bowed down, never surrendered to my commandments, never ever submitted. Take his name and take his soul to the Sijin, which is a place at the bottom of the seven earth. Go take him down there. So فَالسَّابِقَاتِ سَبَقَ means the angels are racing with one another to fulfill the commands of Allah, whatever command Allah gives. فَالْمُدَبِّرَاتِ أَمْرًا. And those who arrange each matter, any where to go, where to take the soul out, who to go to, all that is basically Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordained angels for all of that. So Allah has mentioned five things that the angels are doing. They are taking the soul out with violence. Some of them are taking the soul out with ease. Yes. And then third, they are gliding and swimming towards the heaven. They are racing one another to fulfill the commandments of Allah. And they are arranging all the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever Allah tells them to do, they are doing. These are the five things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken an oath. But whenever Allah takes an oath, there is an answer as well. There's a jawabul qasam, we call it. And that is basically the reason why Allah has taken an oath here is to tell us that the Yawmul Qiyamah is definitely will take place. How do we know? We look at the next verse. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَةِ. So that's how we connect it. After all the five qasam, يَوْمَ تَرْجُفُ الرَّاجِفَةِ, on the day the blast will shake, when Israfil will blow the trumpet, the whole world will shake, everything will collapse and break into pieces, even the heaven and the earth will be, even the heaven, the skies will be torn apart. إِذَا السَّمَاءٌ فَطَرَتْ إِذَا السَّمَاءٌ شَقَّتْ. They will be. So this is the when we look at the five verses and look at the next verses, then you realize why Allah has taken an oath. Most likely the people, they were rejecting Yawmul Qiyamah. So Allah is saying, why are you rejecting the occurrence of Yawmul Qiyamah when I have angels, they will be at my disposal whenever I give them a command. Now going back to my earlier question, why is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes an oath in the Quran? Okay, why does Allah make oaths in the Quran? You'll find so many verses in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken a qasam. Sometimes Allah takes the qasam on Himself. فَوَرَبِّكَ لَنَحْشُرَنَّهُمْ. And I swear by your Lord, Allah has taken an oath on Himself. So why does Allah Azza wa Jal always taking the qasam? Sometime wal fajri, I swear by the dawn. Wal shamsi, I swear by the sun. Wal qamari, I swear by the moon. So many different qasam you notice in the Quran. Wal fajri, wal layli, wal shamsi, wal qamari, wal tini, wal zaytuni. There's a typo here. These are so many verses that we find. Let me fix this typo because I don't want anyone to, sorry about this. I've got an OCD when I see an Arabic mistake. Let me just fix that quickly. Can't take Arabic mistakes. So, okay, it's sorted now. So, وَالْفَجْرِ وَاللَّيْلِ وَالشَّمْسِ وَالْقَمَرِ وَالتِّينِ وَالزَّيْتُونِ. The first answer to all this is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala communicated in a style common to the recipients. Allah is talking to the people, those who existed at the time of revelation. We are talking about who? We're talking about the Arabs. They were in poetry, they were taking a lot of oath as well. That's the reason why. Yes? So to oath by Allah is only for emphasis and attention. That's the only reason why. It's not for any other reason. When Allah says, Wal-Fajri, it's to create that attention. Like, you know what? What I'm about to say, you need to listen. You need to be very attentive now. Because I'm going to say something very important. So it's for emphasis. It's to create that attention. That's one of the answers ulama have given. This is an answer by a very knowledgeable scholar, by Imam Al-Razi, rahimahullah ta'ala. The second one, he said, when Allah takes the oath of any creation of His, like these are all creation of Allah. Wal Fajr, who created the dawn? Wal Layl, who created the night? Wal Shams, the sun? Wal Qamar, the moon? These are all the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? So whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes the oath of any creation of His, the base behind them is the greatness of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created, He's telling us that all the things that I'm taking an oath, I have created all of them. They indicate towards my oneness, and they indicate towards my greatness. So recognize my creation and recognize the Creator. And that's the second reason behind it. This is also an opinion of a scholar as well. And the third opinion is very popular, but it's very weak. That is, to respect for the thing on which oath is made is only. But I've added this one, when it is Allah or His signs. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He said, وَالتِّينِ وَالزَّيْتُونِ, Allah is not telling us to respect olives and figs here. So, if it basically means to recognize the signs of Allah. So the first two opinions about the qasam is very profound, very strong. So once again, why Allah takes an oath? Number one is to basically create attention, and it's for the emphasis, ta'kidul jumla. And the second reason is why is basically to mention the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, these are the two reasons. Yes.
I heard that one more reason, possible reason is that Allah is making them witness on the Day of Judgment.
Making whose witness? The creation.
No, the oaths are like taking of them, like Fajr. So Fajr is witnessing us.
Could be. But there are seven reasons. I summarized to three. Because all the other reasons, I find them weak. These are the reasons that the majority of the ulama have mentioned. Very strong evidence for these three. The first two are the ones that are very popular. The third one I only mentioned because most people, this is what they say. They say that, you know, that's the reason. But the first two are the most important ones. Yeah? I'll take more questions, inshallah, later. Then moving to the next verse, verse number 6. يَوْمَ تَرُجُفُ الرَّاجِفَ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, on the day the blast will shake. This is the first trumpet. It's going to be blown twice. The first time when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will command Israfil alayhi salam to blow the trumpet, this was going to happen. Rajifa means the horn, when he will blow onto the horn, it will shake. Rajaf basically means that it's going to shake. Tatba'uha radifa, followed by the second one. And then the second one. The first one will, all the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will all die. وَنُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ فَصَعِقَ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا مَنْ شَاءَ اللَّهِ. It is mentioned that when Israfil will blow on the trumpet, then everything on the heaven and the earth and whatever it contains, okay, except for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِلَّا مَنْ شَاءَ اللَّهِ, and whoever Allah wants, besides them, everything will fall down unconscious. And Imam Ibn Kathir mentioned that on that day, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his angels, Jibreel, Mikael, Israfil, Malakul Maut, and the Hamalatul Arsh, mean those who are holding the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Besides them, everything will die. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to Jibreel and Mikael, that you know what, Jibreel, anta khalqu min khalqi, Jibreel, you are also a creation of mine. And Allah will say, liyamut Jibreel wa Mikael, let Jibreel and Mikael die as well. So the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, ya Allah, yamutu Jibreel wa Mikael, are you going to cause Jibreel and Mikael to die as well? Allah will say, uskut, faqad katabtu al-maut ala man kana tahta arshi. I have ordained death for all the creation beneath my throne. No one under my throne will live. Allah wants to demonstrate his qudra. And then Jibreel will die. Mikael will die as well. Then the Malakul Maut, you know, the angel who caused everyone to die, he will be shaking. He knows he's next. Allah will say, tell the Malakul Maut to come. And the Malakul Maut will present himself in front of Allah. Allah will say, "Anta khalqun min khalqi, khalaqtuka lima ra'aytu fika." You are but a creation of mine. I created you for a purpose. You have now done that purpose. Now it's finished. Your task has ended. Mut. And then even the angel of death will die. And then the Hamalatul Arsh, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then will command the Hamalatul Arsh, those who are holding the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will say they should die as well. What's going to happen? Our logic tells that the arsh will have to collapse? No. The arsh will remain wherever it is by the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the hadith continues, فَلَمْ يَبْقَ إِلَّا الْوَاحِدُ الْأَحَدُ الْفَرْضُ الصَّمَدُ. And then you only have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing but Allah azza wa jal. So this is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about Yawm al-Qiyamah, this is what's going to happen. Allah will say that, Israfil, go ahead, do it. And then Rajifa is going to shake the whole dunya. And everyone and whatever it contains will die. تَتْبَعُهَا الرَّادِفَةَ, followed by the second one. The second one, ثُمَّ نُفِخَ فِيهِ أُخْرَى فَإِذَا هُمْ قِيَامٌ يَنْظُرُونَ. For the second trumpet, all that who passes away, they will stand again from the grave. Now Allah is talking about what's going to happen when they will come out of the grave. The second nafqa, after the second time. قُلُوبٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ وَاجِفَةَ. The hearts that day will tremble. Because they know they have to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They know that they have to face Allah Azza wa Jal. And أَبْصَارُهَا خَاشِعَةً, and the eyes will be humbled, looking down, because they know that I don't have anything to, I have no a'mal salih, I have no good deeds to present in front of Allah. They will be saying that, what do I have to put in front of Allah Azza wa Jal? So Allah is telling us, all the people that they walk around with their chest open, they walk around like, you know, showing the, yeah, on that day, their hearts will be trembled, they will be shaking. And all the people who, like, you know, keeps on looking at things that they shouldn't be looking at, on that day they'll be looking down, they'll be casted, because they were too scared to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then يَقُولُونَ إِنَّا لَمَرْدُودُونَ فِي الْحَافِرَةِ. Now Allah is reminding us how the disbelievers, they used to speak to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, giving da'wah was very difficult. We get the idea in the Quran when we read verses like this. They used to say, but every sentence that we're reading now, they used to say to the Muslim is mocking. They should say that, أَإِنَّا لَمَرْدُودُونَ فِي الْحَافِرَةِ. Will we indeed be returned to our former state of life? Are you telling us when we die and we will be in our graves, you're telling us we're going to go be resurrected again and go back to life again? You know, when even if we should be decayed bones, we will be rotten bones, broken bones, body will be decomposed. أَإِذَا كُنَّا عِظَامًا نَخِرًا. This was their objection every time when the Prophet of Allah is to talk about Resurrection Day. Whenever the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to say that there is life after death, they're like, it doesn't make sense to us. How can we basically will be like, our body will be decomposed, our bones will be rotten, how do you say that we will be resurrected again? And then they should say that, قالوا تلك إذا كرة خاسرة. Yeah, then this would be a losing return. If you're going to go back to the dunya again, then it's going to, we're going to be all in loss, because you know all the food that we had, we already ate it. All the cattle, we already used it. They're mocking. These whole sentences, these three verses here, is actually the sarcasm from the disbelievers. And from this you can understand, because the Prophet of Allah is to preach, saying that get ready for the hereafter. This, because there is another life. This life is not the end. You know, like, you know, what the disbeliever, they say today, you only live once. You know, it's all right. You know, come on, man. That's just, you know, we're going for a party. Are you going to join us? No, I can't. Come on, man. You only live once. That's the motto now. You know, you only live once. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said to them, you don't live once. The real life is hereafter. Dunya is temporary. This is what? How many years? We all have to go. There are so many of our relatives have already gone. We're going to join them. Many of us sitting here, how many of us here have lost our dear ones? In this COVID-19, how many millions of people have died? And we've been witnessing all of that. You know, one of my colleagues, Mawlana Rafiq, those of you know him from Markaz Christian Institute, you know, 2-3 weeks before, he was calling us on the phone just to get some, like, you know, I'm looking to get my son married, you know. And mashallah, you know, you teach a lot of women, a lot of girls at Ibrahim College. Can you find someone for? No worry, Sheikh. Next week, found out he's going to the hospital. The following week, I prayed his janazah salah. Just nothing. We all have to leave, brothers and sisters. We are not here forever. So the Prophet of Allah is to say that the real life is hereafter. Get ready for this. We're going to have a really great time in the hereafter. Let's prepare for it. They used to mock the Prophet of Allah. What are you talking about? Inna lamarduduna fil hafira. Are we going to go back to our former state? Are we going to go back to the other, you know, life again? Aida kunna idhaman nakhira, when we will become rotten bones. Qalu tilka idhan karratun khasira. Then they say this would be a losing return, because we don't have any, all the savings that we had is all gone now. So this, they were laughing and mocking the Muslims, saying all the money that we saved is all finished now. When we go back to the dunya, we've got nothing to spend on. And they're just laughing, basically. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very angry now. He says, tell them, فَإِنَّمَا هِيَ زَجْرَةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ. What are they worried about? What are they scared of? Do they really doubt my power? Tell them it's going to be زَجْرَةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ. It will be only one shout for me to, like, destroy the whole world. I don't need an army of angels. I don't need, like, so many angels, like, you know, no. Zajratun wahidatun, there will be one shout. Israfil is ready. All I have to do is command him, and then he's going to blow the trumpet. The whole dunya will come to an end. And then they will die, and then for the second time Israfil will blow, and then fa'idahum bisahira, when suddenly every one of them will be upon the surface of this earth. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla will gather all of them again. The word sahira means a maidan, a field that has no barriers. It has no trees. It has no mountains. It's one place. Everyone's going to be gathered again. Where? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Okay, this is the meaning of sahira. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ مُوسَى. It's really interesting. Whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned a story to our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah bring Musa alayhi wa sallam story after that. Yes? Because you see, the people were giving him such a hard time. So Allah said, Muhammad, you're not alone. Moses, he got very tough time as well. These people witnessed miracle. Try to imagine this. They crossed the Red Sea. After they crossed the Red Sea, they went to the other side. They just looked back. I said, wow, Pharaoh is all destroyed. His whole army is destroyed. The sea was split into halves, and they crossed it. Can you imagine one of the greatest miracles they have witnessed? They went to the other side, because Moses, shall we worship some idols now? You know, ilahan kama lahum aliha. These people are worshiping idols. So Moses, can you make some idols for us as well? He said, what are you? Innakum qawmun tajhalun. You people are jahil. You just witnessed a miracle of Allah Azza wa Jal. Then Allah has given them mannu and salwa, food coming from heaven. They're getting all ready made, packed lunch, everything in front of them, eating it. Yeah, and they said, yeah, we're bored now. We want something different. So imagine what Musa al-Islam was going through every single day with them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he brings the story of Musa al-Islam. That's one of the reasons. Okay, that's one of the reasons. That's the connection here. But there are other reasons as well. So I'm going to actually go to this. Why is Prophet Musa mentioned repeatedly in the Quran? Because some of this madmoon, some of this topic are very important. I'm not going to repeat again. Okay? So Musa alayhi salam is mentioned almost every single chapter you'll find it. In Surah Al-Baqarah, in Surah Al-Imran, in Surah Al-Nisa, in Surah Al-Ma'idah. Read the Quran, you'll see Musa alayhi salam is mentioned in every, even in Surah, you know, in the Juz Amma is mentioned, as we are, you know, the first time reading about him now. We'll read about him again in another surah as well. Why? One of the reasons is because the audience of the Quran at the time of revelation were Jews as well. Not only Muslim. The Prophet of Allah was talking to the Muslims, he was talking to the Ahlul Kitab, and they knew Musa alayhi salam very well. Yes? And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is also talking to the disbelievers, the mushrikeen, the idolaters, the different types of people. One of the audience were the Jews, and the Jews, they know Musa alayhi wa sallam very well. Only problem is they don't have the authentic information about Musa alayhi wa sallam. Most of the things were made up. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is to know the actual, correct, accurate information about Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should remind them so that the Jews will come closer to Islam. And many, many people, they embrace Islam. Alhamdulillah. The second reason, as I told you before, is that there's similarities between the Sharia of Nabi Musa and the Sharia of Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Very. And you know, our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he's to always remember Musa alayhi salam. You know, once someone, he said amongst the audience, he was a new Muslim and he didn't have strong iman. He said, "Oh Prophet of Allah, you are not being fair. When it comes to distributing the spoils of war, you're not being fair. You're giving it to the other people more, you gave me less." So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he looked down and he was very upset. He said, "Idha la a'dil faman ya'dil?" If I'm not fair and just, tell me who will be just on this earth. I have been sent by Allah to be fair. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, he just basically said something, he mumbled something. And another time the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was also, he was very much hurt when someone made an accusation against him. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he looked up and he said, "Rahim Allahu akhi Musa." May Allah have mercy on my brother Musa. May Allah have mercy on my brother Moses. "Laqad udhiya bi akthara min hadha fasabar." He was given so much more. He was hurt so much more. He was given much more pain than I'm receiving. And he done sabr. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was only, what, 23 years of preaching. Musa alayhi wasallam was many, many more years as well. And they used to always say something to him. Musa alayhi wasallam, once he said in Surah Baqarah, we'll be doing the tafsir inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded you to sacrifice a cow. So you get a cow, you sacrifice. They're like, "Oh, ma lawnuha, what color is it? You know, what does it do? Or what do the cow do? You know, where will we going to find this cow?" Yeah. "Or tell us, like, you know, is the cow, what's the size of that cow?" You know. And they ask him so many questions that he became so tired. Musa alayhi salam. This is how it was. And the Prophet of Allah said, "Rahim Allahu akhi Musa." You know, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on my brother Moses. He was hurt, he was abused, and they said they done so much to him, but he done sabr. So that's the connection. The Prophet of Allah is to find some sort of tasalli, solace, and contentment when you should read the story of Musa alayhi salam. It's like Allah saying that, oh Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these disbelievers are mocking, don't worry about it. Pharaoh did the same thing as well. Look what we've done to him. And Musa alayhi wa sallam, in his time, you know, these similar things happen as well. Look, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calming the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the final reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, because you know what? It is the clash between haqq and batil. That's the truth. Always remember, whenever Musa alayhi salam gets mentioned and Fir'aun gets mentioned, remember it is a clash of haqq, truth, and it's a clash of batil, falsehood. And that clash will continue forever. That clash will continue forever and ever. And remember, batil is going to be always stronger. So don't be scared. The batil, the falsehood will be always stronger. Stronger means like they'll have more numbers, more weapons, more people, and etc. like this. Now, nowadays, you know, look, they have the media is against us. Every day you put a CNN on, or Fox on, or BBC News, anything like that. And everyone is sat down very nicely. And what are they talking about? Muslims. You know, these Muslims, women, they are oppressed, you know. The most important topic is about the women in Afghanistan now. They will never talk about the fact that they were humiliated and kicked out from there. With all the weapons they had, you have the uncle, chachas, everything with their own, you know, broken sword, they kicked them out. You know, they don't talk about that. Well, they talk about Muslim women are oppressed now. All of a sudden, they're like our well-wishers now, you know. They got so much concern about our women now. It's going to be always a clash between haqq and batil. Yeah? You probably see the batil is winning Allah says, no, the final victory will be for the people of Haqq. Musa alayhi salam and the Israelites, they were so small in number, they had nothing. They had no weapons, nothing. Like, how are they going to fight the mighty Pharaoh? He's got armies, he's got everything. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, I am with you. When Musa alayhi salam reached in the Red Sea, it was a mistake by Musa alayhi salam. He knew how to go, but it's a small mistake that he made. It wasn't a mistake, it was the plan of Allah. So suddenly Musa alayhi salam said, I don't understand, I went to Madian twice. When Pharaoh kicked him out, he went to Madian. Then he returned from Madian. He knew the way very well, but he made a mistake. And then suddenly, everyone laughing at him. Well, Moses, oh Moses, you don't know your way. Look what you have done. Okay, you brought us here so that we get drowned. Musa alayhi salam, no worry, we'll retreat and find the way. But they turned around Pharaoh's behind. And they said, Inna la mudrakun. Pharaoh's here, he's going to kill us. And then everyone again, they start laughing at Musa. Ah, you know, you brought us here to get killed and etc. Musa alayhi salam said, Kalla, never. Inna ma'ya rabbi sayahdin. My Lord is with me and he will guide me. Every time you think the falsehood is winning, every time you think that you know the battle is taking over, remember, Inna ma'ya rabbi, Allah is with us. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always reminds us.
Would you not say many stories, or perhaps all of the stories in the Quran, about the prophets, about the clash between Haqq and Allah?
Yes, you will say the same. But Musa alayhi salam's one is mentioned in that detail, not any other prophet stories are mentioned like that. Because if you look at all the other battle, they were small in numbers. Pharaoh was the mightiest, is the biggest. And it's a clash of Haqq and Batil continues all the way. All the prophets, but Musa alayhi salam's and Fir'aun's story is a real clash. Because every single day they were suffering. So it's a continuous reminder. And if you look at, for example, at the time of Nuh alayhi salam, you don't look at the peoples with you know, you just look at the flood. You know, if you look at Yunus alayhi salam, no one talks about how strong the armies were. When you talk about Pharaoh straight away, the army comes in front of you, Pharaoh's mightiness and his roughness and toughness, his oppression, and all of that comes in front of you, which highlights the way we're living now. Okay, that's the reason why. Moving on, then 5 more minutes inshallah ta'ala, I'll stop. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, go to Pharaoh. فَقُلْ هَلْ لَكَ إِلَىٰ أَن تَزَكَّ. Go tell him that, say to him, would you be willing to purify yourself? You know, the Israelite, I mean, the Jews, they believe that Moses was only chosen to be a prophet to deliver them. Quran disagrees with that. Okay, the biblical narration is that Moses was only sent to this dunya just to take them out of bondage. Just to take them out, just to deliver them. I would take them away from Pharaoh. That's it. That's the only. But Quran says no. Every single prophet, the main reason they are sent to the dunya is for da'wah. So Allah said, go to Pharaoh, give him da'wah. Because Allah said that, tell him, halaka ila an tazakka. Would you like to purify your heart? I could help you. You know, your heart is rotten. You need to clean yourself. You think, who do you think you are? You are nothing but a servant of God. Recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tell him this. وَأَهْدِيَكَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ فَتَخْشَىٰ. Let me guide you to your Lord so that you would fear Him. You need to learn who Allah is. Don't think you are everything. You are nothing. You are a creation of Allah. Allah's got Jibreel. If you see Jibreel, you will shake. Even the Prophet of Allah was shaking when he saw him. So you are nothing, Pharaoh. Go tell him this. Allah is teaching the Prophet of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah is teaching Musa alayhi wa sallam, that go tell Pharaoh. And teaching him how to give da'wah to Pharaoh. فَأَرَاهُ الْآيَةَ الْكُبْرَىٰ. Moses went to Pharaoh, gave him the full da'wah, told him about Allah and the heaven and the earth. We'll read about it in Surah Taha, inshallah ta'ala. But, and he showed him the greatest sign. He had this staff with him, he put it under the floor, he turned into a snake. And then he put his hand under his armpit, it became like a torchlight. And he said that, look, this is not jadu, this is not sihr, this happened by the command of Allah. But what did Pharaoh do? فَكَذَّبَ وَعَصَىٰ. He denied and disobeyed. You see, I said this many times, the disbeliever, they always will deny the commands of Allah. They always will disobey the commands of Allah. Do you know why? They don't want to change the way of life. So many people out there, they know Allah is the one. He is alone. He has no partner. But they just don't want to change their lives because it's too difficult. They want to carry on the way they are. If you change your life, then you know, you can't have, according to them, they think they can't have any more fun anymore. So Pharaoh doesn't want to give up his kursi, his chair, and all the people that he thinks he owns them. ثُمَّ أَدْبَرَ يَسْعَى. Then he turned his back and then he hurried. He walked, you know, striving means he walked out of the room. Yes? So one of the things that we learn from this, Quran tells us that giving da'wah to Pharaoh it was also one of the tasks of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. This is something that we learn from the Quran, completely different from the biblical narration that we get. And then فَحَشَرَ فَنَادَى فَقَالَ أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى. And then he gathered all the people and he said, Moses was preaching me about God Almighty. I am, na'udhu billah, God Almighty. I am your most exalted Lord. And Allah doesn't like that. You know, you cannot, two things Allah hates. Number one, for anyone to declare that he is God. And secondly, anyone to say that he is a prophet. Two things Allah hates the most. And anyone has done that, you will read the history, they are humiliated. Whoever declared that he is a God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala humiliates him, embarrasses him. For example, if you remember at the time of Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam, and again in Surah Al, in we're going to read about him inshallah ta'ala in Surah Ali Imran and other verses as well. Namrud, when Ibrahim alayhi salam gave him da'wah, you know, he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he bring the sun from the east. Inna Allah ya'ti bi shamsi min al mashriq. فَأْتِ بِهَا مِنَ الْمَغْرِبِ. If you think you have the power of Allah, you bring it from the west. The reason why Ibrahim alayhi salam said this, do you know why? Because Ibrahim alayhi salam said, my Lord, yuhyi wa yumit. He give life and death. Namrud was in the court. You know, when you're in your court and you have all the entourage in front of you and the guards, you don't feel like to be embarrassed. So Namrud said, really? He gives life and death? Yeah. أَنَا وُحْيِ umit. I also give life and death as well. And he called two persons. Come here. He said, God, kill him. And they killed him. He goes, you are free to go. And the guy, yeah, I'm happy. And he ran away. Okay. He says, see, قَتَلْتُ رَجُلًا وَتَرَكْتُ رَجُلًا أَنَا أُحْيُ أُمِيدٌ. Your Lord is very weak. I killed one and I let one go. I give life and death. So Ibrahim got very angry. Oh, you foolish person. You're not understanding the power of Allah. Allah bring the sun from the east. The sun is out there. Go, change the sun. Bring it from the west. Show me. فَبُهِتَ الَّذِي كَفَرْ. And the disbeliever was left speechless, stunned. He didn't know what to do. But someone, Mufassirin, they say, why didn't Namrud say, I am the one who bring you from the east, you bring from the west, because he knows he's a prophet. So this is another thing as well. Deep down he knows he's the prophet. And if you will say to God, he will do it, then everyone's going to embrace Islam. So Allah always humiliates the people of the batil. You don't, when you say you are God, or you have the power of God, Allah will humiliate. And Namrud, by the way, he died. Ulama have mentioned a mosquito went inside his nose and then reached the brain and he died. Never ever you say that I am God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will humiliate you. Another thing Allah hates the most, if anyone who says that I am a prophet. Because Allah is the one who Allahu a'lam wa haythu yaj'alu risalata. Allah is the one who chooses who to be the prophet. Anyway, he said that I am your most exalted Lord. Allah says, فَأَخَذَهُ اللَّهُ نَكَالَ الْآخِرَةِ وَالْأُولَى إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ لَعِبْرَةً لِمَنْ يَخْشَى. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala seized him in an exemplary punishment for the last and the first. Allah will give him a punishment in the dunya as well as in the akhirah as well. He's going to get punishment for the last and for the first. And Allah says, إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ لَعِبْرَةً لِمَنْ يَخْشَى. Indeed, in that is a warning for whoever would fear Allah. Contemplate on the story of Musa. See what happened to Pharaoh. And Allah said that if you contemplate, then there's an ibrah for you. Pharaoh thought he's got everything. He has slaves, he has money, he had palaces, he had the power, he had the name, he had the fame, he had everything. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala humiliated him because why? Because he didn't recognize the power of Allah. He didn't submit himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He didn't listen to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. The same Musa who grew up in his own palace. And he didn't listen to him. This is a lesson for all of us. That you know what, just because Allah has given you something, don't think that Allah can't take this away from you. Because when Pharaoh and his people were drowned, Allah says, كَمْ تَرَكُوا مِنْ جَنَّاتٍ وَعُيُونَ وَزُرُوعٍ وَمَقَامٍ آخَرِينَ. You know, these people have left all the gardens and all the palaces and all the lands, agricultural land, everything, they left all behind. Allah says, ثُمَّ أَوْرَثْنَاهَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ. I gave all this to the Israelite after them. Okay, and Pharaoh did nothing. He wanted, all the lofty palaces was left empty. So everything that we have in the dunya is only for temporary. So Allah says, إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ لَعِبْرَةً. Take ibrah. Indeed, there is a lesson for everyone to learn, or a warning for those who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the verse continues, and I will stop now inshallah ta'ala. We're going to do this next week. I left behind two ayat. I probably did. Which one? From where? Have I left that? Yes, that's true. ثم أدبر يسعى فحشر فنادى فقال أن ربكم الأعلى. What happened? I think when I don't do slides, I made some changes. Sorry. Okay. إذ ناداه ربه بالواد المقدس طوى اذهب إلى فرعون إنه طغى فقل هل لك إلى أن تزكى. That's right. Actually, this, I added this slide just now. There you go. هل أتاك حديث موسى? Has there reached to you the story of Musa? إذ ناداه ربه بالواد المقدس طوى. When his Lord called to him in the sacred valley of Tua, اذهب إلى فرعون إنه طغى. Go to Pharaoh, for he has exceeded all bounds. I went straight to the next, you know, why Musa is mentioned. That's right. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, that Musa, I am calling you to present yourself in the valley of Tua. That's the valley that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called him. He went there, then Allah Azza wa Jal sent revelation to him, as mentioned in Surah Taha, Surah Qasas, Surah Al-A'raf, and so many other surahs, the whole story. Here Allah is just summarizing, and Allah just said that, go to Pharaoh. Why? Innahu tagha. Because he has exceeded all bounds. Remember, we read in Surah Al-Naba, everyone remember, لِلطَّاغِينَ tagha, I said to you before as well, the word tagha and tagheen mean those who exceed all bounds. He has exceeded all the boundaries, not just sinning. He said, "Ana Rabbukumul A'la." The greatest sin to say that he is the Lord Almighty, yeah. And then Allah Subhanahu wa Taala, "Idhab ila Fir'auna, innahu tagha." And then, "Fakul halaka ila antazaka barakallahu fik." Inshallah, Taala, we will continue from the next ruku, which is starts from here. أنتم أشد خلقا أم السماء بناها رفع سمكها فسواها وأغطش ليلها وأخرج ضحاها والأرض بعد ذلك دحاها. We'll continue from there, inshallah. I will take any question that anyone have. بارك الله فيكم. Yes, please. Go ahead.
Firstly, could you explain the meaning of Sharia and clarify how the link between Musa and Sharia and Musa. Okay.
So the brother said that, what is the meaning of Sharia? And what is the link between?
The link you're making between the Prophet Sharia and Musa.
And what is the link between the Prophet Sharia and the Musa Sharia? I think you're talking about this number two that I made, yeah? So I said that the Sharia, the similarities between the Sharia of Nabi Musa and Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The meaning of Sharia is anything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated for you to follow. So all the commandments of Allah is called Sharia. So this is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the Sharia takhtalif. The Sharia differs from prophet to prophet. So in the Sharia of Sulaiman alayhi salam, for example, you're allowed to make statues. The Sharia of Nabi Muhammad, you can't make statues. The Sharia of Yusuf alayhi salam, you're allowed to prostrate. You could fall into prostration to thank someone. Like for example, the children, they could do sajda in front of the parents to thank them. Okay? But the Sharia of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam, you cannot do that. So there are something here. The Sharia of Sulaiman alayhi salam, you're allowed to make images and sculptures and 3Ds, but not in our Sharia, for example. So the Sharia changes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he talks about fasting, he said, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. Fasting has been prescribed upon you like it was prescribed upon those before you. So Allah draws a link. So the Sharia basically means the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given to each prophet and the followers at a specific time. Yeah? So you could find this Sharia as commandments of God. So there's a similarity between the commandments of Nabi Musa, the commandments that Allah has given to Musa alayhi salam. They had to pray salah as well. Because they said to Musa alayhi salam, Pharaoh is not allowing us to pray. You know, we need to go in that specific area, our area of worship, that we need to go and pray there. But Pharaoh said that if we leave our house and go to this designated area, he's going to kill us. He said, اجعلوا بيوتكم قبلة وأقيموا الصلاة. Pray at home. Which I quoted when the lockdown happened. So we're going to revive this verse, inshallah ta'ala. We're going to make our houses into the place of worship like the Israelites did at the time of Musa alayhi salam. You know, our Pharaoh is COVID basically. Yeah. So we're going to turn our houses into the place of worship. So can you see, they have to fast as well. They have to give zakat as well. They have to give sadaqah as well. So there's a similarity between our Sharia and the Sharia of Musa alayhi salam. The difference is in details. However, whenever Allah's Prophet is to command people to do something, the disbeliever is to mock. whenever Musa alayhi salam used to command them, they used to mock as well. And that's why I said there's a similarity between the Sharia of Nabi Musa and Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam. That's the reason. Yes, anyone else have any other questions? Go ahead. Okay. Asif, make sure that if there's any question from the sisters, that we do justice to this, okay? Yes. Go ahead.
My question was regarding Musa. So, obviously, I don't know what to do, but I just want to know, Musa, did he have a natural death? How did he pass away?
Yeah, all the prophets, sorry, I'm going to repeat the question for the sisters. Did Musa alayhi salam have a natural death? Okay? All the prophets, all the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they need to have a natural death. What do you mean by natural?
Was it like
a normal death, right? Oh, okay. So, yeah, all the prophets, you know, some of the prophets will die, you know, by giving da'wah, but natural death means that he had a normal death. So what happened to Musa alayhi salam? It is actually mentioned about his death. The last wish of Musa alayhi salam was to enter the al-ard al-muqaddasa. His desire was to enter Jerusalem. He said, "Oh Allah," because his mission was to take the people out of Egypt and go towards Jerusalem. But the Israelites, you know, they didn't listen to him and they gave him such a tough time. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, "Yatihuna fil ard." They will be wandering around in the desert and they would not find their way. So Musa alayhi salam, in that time, death came to him. So he said, "Oh Allah, I see that my time is here for me to go, but at least let me get closer to Jerusalem." So Musa alayhi salam was walking towards. So when he went towards Jerusalem, just on the outskirts of Jerusalem, he passed away. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned in a Sahih hadith that when I was going for Mi'raj, when I was going for Isra, traveling from Mecca to Jerusalem and from there to Mi'raj, to the heaven, I saw Musa alayhi salam. Ra'aytuhu yusalli fi qabrihi. I saw him praying salah in his grave. And I know exactly where he is. And he said to the companion, "If you guys were with me, I would show you his grave. Indal Kathib al-Ahmar." He's in an area called Kathib al-Ahmar. Okay, which is just outskirts of Jerusalem. And the Qabr is still there. If anyone go to Jerusalem, you know, that's what they do. They take you to the area. They said this area is known as Kathib al-Ahmar, and this is where Musa alayhi salam is buried. Alayhi salatu wasalam. Yeah.
Are you able to explain the hikmah behind the different sharia's, or the differences in the respective sharia's of Musa alayhi salam, and other prophets?
Later on?
Earlier on. So Isa alayhi salam, I'm assuming there was a different sharia.
Yeah. What's the question, sorry?
The hikmah. But could you explain the hikmah behind the respective differences between the sharia's?
The hikmah behind it?
Yeah.
Salam, so second.
One of the sisters had a question.
Okay. Yes.
That when the soul is removed as a bad person, it comes out very in a bad way. And what about for good people? You know, when good people that believe, their souls come out badly as well. Like, what's the reason for that?
So the good people, they believe their soul comes out badly.
Yeah.
Well, first of all, they shouldn't believe in that, because as I said to you, one of the thing about death, we do not know. When we are witnessing death, we don't know how the soul is coming out. You know, looks can be very deceiving. This is the reason why the ulama, they say that if someone passes away, sometimes the mouth is open, sometimes the eyes are open. The reason why the eyes are open, because they look at the soul. When the soul is taken away, they follow it. So the eyes remain open. And ulama, they said that close the eyes after that and close the mouth straight away. Okay? Some people, they say, oh, if his mouth is open, that means he's hungry. If his eyes are open, that means he was scared. All these are wrong. We should never ever do this. Okay? This is the reason why, you know, only wise people, they should be by the deathbed. When someone passes away, people who could control and they know a bit of Sharia, they should be there. Because a lot of people are, you know, don't do a selfie or a recording and all that. You know, these are the things that people are doing nowadays. It's horrible. You know, people are dying, they record this. And because these things are haram. We should not do that. Yeah? But the angels, we should never ever doubt about. We should always have good thoughts about our fellow Muslim brothers and sisters. ظُنُّوا بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ خَيْرًا. You should always think good about your mu'mineen, your brothers and sisters, and say, Alhamdulillah, he had a good death, she had a good death, okay? And the rest is in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We can never ever tell. The Prophet of Allah, when he was passing away, he said, Inna lil mawti sakarat. Oh, there is agony in death. The Prophet of Allah said that he was feeling it. What about me and you? So there is a pain that we all gonna go through that. But that pain will be eased, inshaAllah ta'ala. You feel it, but it's going Allah Azza wa Jal will make it very easier for us. We should never ever think that someone is having a tough death or a bad death like that. We should expect that, inshaAllah ta'ala, this is an easy death. Because the death is basically the departing of the soul. That moment when the soul is taken out, that is the most difficult moment. Only Allah knows. And this person who is actually dying, he or she will know what kind of pain it will cause. So yeah, we should not think anything otherwise and believe that inshallah ta'ala, this person having a good death. Hope that answers your questions, inshallah ta'ala. Coming back to your questions, the Sharia.
Yeah, so the difference is in Sharia. The difference between Musa alayhi salam Sharia as compared to the Prophet alayhi salam Sharia, as compared to Isa alayhi salam, the slight differences as you say.
Yeah.
What would be the hikmah, or possible hikmah at least,
I'll try to answer that because that needs a bit more detail. So the brother's question is that what is the hikmah of the changes that we see in the Sharia of Isa, the Sharia of Musa, and the Sharia of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Well, Imam Ibn Kathir in his tafsir, he said something so beautiful and profound. He said that every prophet was sent according to the time and custom of that era. So every prophet was fully equipped with the knowledge and wisdom of that time. So at the time of Musa alayhi salam, people thought like, you know, they got into supernatural powers. They were like glorifying the sorcerers and magic. That's why Musa alayhi salam, da'wah and miracle was magic. If you think about it, it's not magic, we're going to call it a miracle. Because this is what they were believed. Yeah. Then time moved on, came the Isa alayhi salam time. Isa alayhi salam time was like all about Greek medicine. That's somehow made it into, it's all about medicine and etc. and finding out the cure for all disease. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what he did, he gave Isa alayhi salam the power, yubri wal akmaha wal abrasa. Yeah? So he was curing those who were born blind or they who had leper because they had no cure for this as well. Then came our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam time. At that time it was all about spoken words, you know, the eloquence of the tongue and poetry, because they were singing poetry. Qifa nabki min dhikra habibin wa manzili bi siqti liwa bayna dakhuli fa hawmali. These are all beautiful words and people used to really get mesmerized by these beautiful words. So the Quran came and just, you know, silenced them. So every era is there's some different challenges, and all the ibadat is to like remove those challenges and to recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So our ibadah is salah, where we recite the Quran, the words, which they used to glorify words. There was nothing this poetry. They used to glorify so much, they used to stick the words in the Kaaba. And they used to have called seven, in one very weak opinion, there were seven poetries, Saba Mu'allaqat, they were hung into the Kaaba. Because the words are so powerful. No one can compose like this. No one can construct sentences like this. So we have salah where Quran is recited. Okay? So this is like every prophet, they have this kind of hikmah behind it. This is one side. I'm sure there are many other ways of looking at it.
Sharia by nature is legal.
Hmm.
Legal commandments.
Commands of Allah, yeah.
You do this, you don't do that.
Yeah.
So that particularly, what would you say if you have to say about that?
No, the commands are do this and do that. Again, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he does nasakh. He said, ma nansakh min ayatin. You know, there are certain things I obligated, there are certain things I abrogated, certain things I've commanded the previous ummah, then I took it out. Allah said that na'ti bi khayri minha, I only bring something that is better. So Allah azza wa jalla, you know, there are certain things, like for example, shirk is haram in all era. Tawheed is permissible in all era. Certain things Allah kept it. Salah and zakah and etc. Allah looks at the ability of human as well. You know, Israelite, they could do certain things. You know, they were living for longer, their physical power was different. So their ibadat was different, you know. Okay? There's more to it, inshallah, you know. Yes, please. Anyone else have any other questions? Ya Allah, tafaddal. Go ahead. Sister, sorry, you're still allowed to ask more questions, so don't worry. Yes, go ahead, please.
Sheikh, I was going to ask, you know, Pharaoh, did he have jinns or anything like that, that he was either, you know, they did magic at that time.
Yeah.
Calling upon them or anything like that.
Nothing about, let me repeat the question. So did Pharaoh have power and assistance from shaitan and jinn and etc., you know, because he was doing so many things like this? No, nothing has been mentioned in the Quran about Pharaoh. You know, the people of Dawood and Sulaiman, at that time they were doing it. Do you get it? At the time of Dawood and Sulaiman, we'll talk about this inshallah in the surahs when we, they were people were trying to get help from the jinn. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave, you know, I read my Salat al-Maghrib today, you know, recollect, وَمِنَ الشَّيَاطِينَ مَنْ يَغُوصُونَ لَهُ وَيَعْمَلُونَ عَمَلًا دُونَ ذَلِكَ. There were some shayateen and jinn they used to work for Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam. But not at the time of Pharaoh. Pharaoh didn't need any help from jinn and etc. like that, because the guy was deluded, first of all. And he had so many people working for him. So he didn't need anything like that. All the people were working for him, and he had such a big army that they used to, like, you know, they were building everything for him, and they were taking all the work from the Israelite. So he didn't need anything like that. He never believed in any of that. He was a kafan chor, we say in Urdu. He was a thief who is to steal from he's a grave robber. He's a grave robber. And my students will ask me, what would you give if you robbed the grave? Well, at the time of Egypt, ancient Egypt, there's law. They used to bury them with the gold and the sword and everything like that. I went actually to Giza, Sheikh. I went to Giza, and they took me to see, you know, 60 feet down. I don't know why I went there. I was so excited. I was so excited with my phone. I'm going to take a picture and etc. Anyway, and then I went there. There's nothing there. It's empty.
It's a box, one big box.
I said to him, I came down. It took me 10 minutes to go there, and he's sweating, you know. Can you believe it? I was so scared that, imagine Allah just closes the other side. We can't get out. I was so scared. Anyway, I thought I'm going to see under the pyramids. Then the guy there, our guide was a very funny guy. He said, I got all of you down here to tell you that there were so many things here. It's all gone to British Museum now. Please, when you go back to England, tell them we want it back. This is why he said he was really. He goes, all this, we had gold here, we had everything. And they came, these thieves, and took it. Yeah, so I want everyone to kind of, because we are from England. So he said, please bring them back here, because we're waiting for this day when our goods will be returned. So Pharaoh is to go, dig, and take all this. That's how he made his, made himself, basically. Suddenly, he became a Pharaoh. Yes. So no, why do you think, like, he probably got assistant of jinn?
No, because when Musa alayhi salam was young, you know, he had the stammer.
Yeah.
Right, he asked him for Allah to help him by sending his brother Harun with him.
Mm.
So send my brother with me. Mm. He was scared of obviously the challenge he had.
Mm.
And the stammer, speaking eloquently,
yeah.
But as we, I've learned a little bit about this a few years ago, so it might not be clear now, Allah forgive me. But when he was young, he had a Pharaoh kind of knew that Musa alayhi salam was pure and kind of, you know, something that was going to challenge him in some way.
Mm.
And so he gave him the charcoal to test him as a child, whether, you know, children, whether it's danger or not, generally they might just pick up something really hot. And he put that charcoal in his mouth and burnt his tongue, and that's how he got the stammer.
Mm.
So I was just thinking, maybe did he know from jinns or anything that this child is, you know, sent from God and is going to cause him some difficulty?
I'm not sure, first of all. I don't think any authentic books have mentioned this. It's not in the hadith. And any the tafsir books, they don't mention. Pharaoh didn't know he was actually Musa. He had a doubt about it, because when the mother came back to suckle him, they tried seven women before her. All seven of the wet nurses Moses rejected. He said, I'm not going to drink from any. Musa Islam was basically rejecting all of them, not drinking from any. And then suddenly this old lady comes, and Musa al-Islam, he jumps, you know, to the lady. Obviously, no one knows that's Musa al-Islam's mother, except for the mother and, you know, and Allah. No one else knows. There's no one else. Musa al-Islam is a baby, but he felt it. So this is when Pharaoh said to the other ones, like, what's going on? Do a bit of research on this lady, you know. And they've done a research. They don't find nothing, because when she was pregnant, no one knew she was pregnant. She looked after herself like this. So they don't know nothing about it. Because, no, this is an old lady. No, you know, no one knows much about her. She can't be. She could never be pregnant and all that stuff. We found no traces of her, etc. So he was certain that. He had that doubt, but he was certain that that's not Musa. So, you know, so I don't think that story. I think sometimes the tafsir scholars, they add this. They get this story from Israeliyat, we call it. You know, these are the Israeli stories. Basically, these are from the previous scriptures. And the Prophet ﷺ said, لا تصدقوها ولا تكذبوها. Don't reject it, but don't also believe in it as well. So we have to take it basically with cautious. Like, if he contradicts Quran and Sunnah, we're going to reject it. And if he doesn't, then we have to be very careful. You know, we don't want to reject it, we don't want to believe in it at the same time, unless we find other hadith telling us to believe in it. So that's why, wallahu alam, Allah knows best. Okay, last question and then I say we'll end it, inshallah. Anyone else?
Assalamu alaikum.
Go ahead, please.
Also, another sister would like to ask, if a believer dies, like upon Iman, and he's read the Kalima, and also he's on Friday at Friday time, obviously he'll be, he will need to, like, what does that indicate? Does he get less punishment on the day of judgment?
Yes, thank you. I've got the question. So, everyone heard the question as well. When a believer, believing person recite La ilaha illallah, this is a very big glad tidings. Because at that time, no matter how much we practice in dunya, on the time of death, the tongue is not in your control anymore. We don't have any control of that tongue. It's in the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the time when we become very weak. So if someone at the time of death, they could say La ilaha illallah, then alhamdulillah, this is a glad tiding. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Man kana akhir kalamihi la ilaha illallah dakhala al-jannah." Whoever's last word could be La ilaha illallah, then they will enter Jannah. So definitely a glad tidings. You know, we enter Islam with La ilaha illallah. That's our first word. We enter into Islam in that we first thing that we learn is La ilaha illallah. That should be our last word as well, La ilaha illallah. So definitely it's a glad tiding. Anyone who dies in Jum'ah, Yawmul Jum'ah, there's lots of, it's a virtuous day to die. Definitely it's a glad tiding. We don't say anything with certainty though. It's a glad tiding. We take, like, you know, this is, we are mutafa'il, we are optimistic that this person will be forgiven, inshallah ta'ala. So we should have this optimism that the forgiveness will be there, inshallah, and we have stronger hope now that this person will be from the dwellers of Jannah. That's what. We don't do any yaqeen, any certainty. Certainty is in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's all it is here, inshallah. Any more questions from the sisters? Okay, inshallah. Barakallahu feekum, everyone. Jazakumullahu khairan. We'll end it here, inshallah. Subhanallah bihamdi. Subhanakallahu bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.